to the Division for Diversity and Inclusion's Shattering the Silences series. My name is Dr. Ken Coopwood, and I'm the Vice President for Diversity and Inclusion here at Missouri State University. This series is a year-round effort to help educate, give credence and voice to important topics for our campus, its divisions, its departments, groups, and individuals. We need these forums to discuss local, regional, and national matters that are important to us. We do not want to be silent about such things, but instead, we want to speak up and speak out with the intention to help dispel myths and to inspire truth. But mostly, the series is designed to bring our campus together for unified service to our students and to each other. Thank you for joining us. Now, let's turn our attention to the topic of this video.
I'm going to try to talk without the microphone. Can everybody hear me? Can you hear me in the back? All right. All right, good. I'm a little dude, but I've got a big mouth. Let's ask my wife. She says that all the time. Thank you, Ken, for the introduction. Thank you all for showing up. Obviously, extra credit points do nice things for swelling a crowd for people, so I appreciate that. Faculty and staff that came out, I appreciate it also. A couple months ago, when I was asked to give this presentation on why diversity matters, I pretty much said sure without hesitating or really thinking about it that much. Being given an hour to talk about something as all-encompassing as the issue of diversity and why it matters turned out to be a little bit of a challenge, trying to figure out what to focus on, how to squeeze everything in, and how to make this an interesting presentation. And I'm going to try to do that. I'm going to try to make this as interesting and informative and useful for all of you as possible, because I know that you're taking time out of your day to come, and I appreciate that. So just a little bit about my background. I am an associate professor in the Sociology and Anthropology Department here at Missouri State. I teach the race and ethnicity course in our program. I've worked with Dr. Coopwood on last year's Collaborative Diversity Conference. I'm helping out again this year with the Collaborative Diversity Conference, and I'm also chairing the committee that's in the process of bringing a diversity studies minor to campus. So I've been involved with the issue of diversity the entire time that I've been here, both on campus and in the community, and so I appreciate this opportunity to be able to come in and speak. And as I was putting together the presentation today, I was just trying to think, you know, if there was one sentence that I could think of that would describe the importance of diversity in American society and in our lives, what would it be? Well, it turned out that somebody else had already said something to the respect of what I was thinking in terms of demography is destiny. And that guy up there, his name is August Comte. He's the founding father of sociology, which is my discipline. Mostly he came up with the name sociology, so he gets credit with finding, with being the founding father of it. But his belief was that we could study the social world in order to change it and make it better. And so by being able to study and understand issues, we can then use that knowledge and use that information to improve the condition of people's lives in society. And I believe as a sociologist, as an academic, and as a member and a citizen of our country and of our community, that's what I try to do. And this sentence to me captures the whole point behind why diversity matters, because our demography is our destiny, and by knowing about the differences that exist in our society and in our communities in terms of a number of different indicators, we can understand where we're headed as a society, we can anticipate what some of the obstacles to getting where we want to be are, and we can take advantage of what those opportunities are that we want to be able to use in order to get the type of world that we want to live in for ourselves, our families, and our children, right? And so that's ultimately the idea here that we're trying to get across. Now, the focus of this presentation is going to be on national trends, opportunities, and challenges as they relate to diversity, but these things are also reshaping the demographic characteristics of cities and communities and universities and other areas across the country. And so what's happening at the national level impacts us locally. And you know the old saying, think globally but act locally. So I'm hoping that some of the takeaways from this will be applicable to your own lives as well. Now, nationally, we hear all kinds of things related to diversity in terms of politics. For example, we know that there's debates going on now about what to do about the immigration issue, about immigration reform. We've heard that allegedly there's going to be some bipartisan movement on that in Congress this year. I'll believe it when I see it, but let's hope that it actually happens. There's been issues related to LGBT marriage equality, discrimination in the workplace, the Employment Non-Discrimination Act, the Defense of Marriage Act have all been political issues that have been debated recently. Workplace protections, equal pay legislation has been part of the discussion to address the pay gap between women and men, dealing with issues related to disability, right? So there's all kinds of things politically in terms of the policy realm where diversity has really been an issue that we have been trying to figure out what are some of the policies we can use to take advantage of the strengths that diversity brings to our country and our communities, and what are some ways that we can limit the challenges that come along with that growing diversity. We also know that diversity is becoming a big kind of catchphrase or a key word in business, right? Over 60% of Fortune 500 companies now have a chief diversity officer. Well, the reason for that is because the workforce is changing. It's no longer just white men who are in charge of everything, who are entering the workforce. The workforce is becoming more diverse in terms of gender, in terms of race and ethnicity, in terms of sexual orientation. So that we have chief diversity officers to be able to handle that integration into the workforce. In terms of education, most college campuses now have something equivalent to our Division of Diversity and Inclusion here on campus, where Dr. Cooper is our vice president. There's vice presidents of diversity all across the country. Part of the accreditation process for universities has to do with how are you encouraging diversity on your campus? What does the climate look like in terms of being welcoming to diverse groups of students and people on campus? So there's no doubt that this is a national issue. Locally, we've got a lot of things going on that focus on diversity as well. Just a few examples that I was able to pull off of the internet here. Our public affairs theme for the year is on global perspective and why it matters, talking about differences. Our collaborative diversity conference this year from the Division for Diversity and Inclusion has to do with diversity and how it relates to community, thinking about diversity and community. Where do educators and businesses and philanthropies fit in for that? The Field Guide 2030, the long-range plan for the city of Springfield. Chapter 5 is a chapter on global perspectives and diversity. We've got a couple of different religions, faith-based diversity initiatives going on in the community. We've got the Race and Faith Collaborative, which is a partnership between faith communities, Missouri State, and the city of Springfield. We've got the Center for Diversity and Reconciliation. And so you can see at the community level, we're acknowledging that diversity is important and we're trying to figure out ways of harnessing that diversity and again, working on strengthening the opportunities that come with an increasingly diverse community and trying to limit the obstacles that are faced by increasing diversity. You'll see that's a theme throughout this talk, is talking about what are the opportunities, what are the obstacles, and how do we deal with them. Now, when we talk about diversity, we need to first say, what do we mean by this term diversity? 9 times out of 10, when somebody talks about diversity, the first thing that pops into your mind is the idea of race or ethnic diversity. But diversity is about more than just race, though race definitely still matters. We still have a lot of issues with race in the United States, in our community, and we can see that in the news almost every day. But race is just one dimension of people's identities, right? People's identities are, and their behaviors, we need to expand our understanding of diversity to incorporate differences beyond race, because the social dimensions of differences play a role in the development of people's identities, behaviors, their access to opportunities, and their experiences in society. All of these things are shaped in complex and interrelated ways. So the experiences of a black female are different from the experiences of a white male. The experiences of an upper class black male are different from the experiences of a lower class Hispanic male, right? In sociology, we have a term for that. We call it intersectionality. how the different dimensions that go into our identities intersect and lead us to the different types of structure of opportunities that we have or the constraints on the types of actions and choices that we make. So diversity can be a very broad term. You can think about it by race, gender, sexual orientation, disability status, age, social class. And all of these things are changing over time as the United States becomes more diverse and as we start expanding our definition of what diversity means. So clearly, this has become a public issue in the US and in our own community here in Springfield. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the changing nature of American society and then what some of the implications of that are. This first figure shows two things. It shows overall the growth of the American population and what it's projected to look like by the year 2050. You can see that between 1950 and 2050, the population of the United States is expected to increase from roughly 150 million people to about 450 million people. We're at about 317 million right now. Over time, the number of women is predicted to gradually increase at a faster rate than the number of men in society. So women currently comprise about 51% of the population. By 2050, they're predicted to make up about 53 to 54% of the population. So gender is going to become more of a kind of dominant issue during that time. In terms of age and population growth, the United States in 1950, you can see, looked kind of like a Christmas tree, right? You've got the base of the tree, made up of the younger people, kind of narrows a little bit at the bottom and then widens in the middle and narrows again at the top. By the year 2000, you can see that we've gotten older as a society. And so the reason for this is that birth rates are declining in the United States and the population is living longer. So the average age is getting older, birth rates are going down, which means our population is getting older. We're not replacing as many of the older people with kids in society anymore. So just some statistics here. In 1950, the median age was 30.2 years for Americans. By 2000, the median age was 35.3 years. By 2050, over 20% of the population is predicted to be over the age of 65. By contrast, the quote-unquote oldest state in the United States right now is the state of Florida. 17.5% of Florida's population is over the age of 65. So by 2050, we'll have a larger percentage of the population being older than the largest percentage of the population in our oldest state right now. That's going to bring significant challenges with it over time. As people are living longer, there's going to be all kinds of issues that come along with that. And you can see the projection by 2050, we're going to kind of balloon out at all age groups here. And so there's some things that are happening that we should be paying attention to. We can think about births, deaths, and immigration as the primary drivers of population growth in the United States throughout time. This one, again, looks at 1950 to 2050 with projections after 2010 based on census projections. And we can see that, first of all, birth rates are declining over time. You can see the baby boom at the far left end of that picture there. And then as the baby boom has kind of slowed down, you can see birth rates have been on a steady decline since that time. Death rates are increasing over time. So what happens when less people are being born and more people are dying? Population growth slows. But over that same time, so between this time, America is actually predicted to grow more slowly in population compared to other countries in the world. And the population growth that we do experience will primarily be driven by increases in immigration and birth rates among newly arrived immigrants. So again, the young people are going to be looking very different from the elderly in our society. And that brings with it a whole host of issues as well. This current crop of first graders that's going through public schools right now in the United States is the first cohort that is majority-minority in the United States in public school. So as they age, they're going to become an increasingly larger, more important part of the population. Racially, over time, we've got three different time periods here for four different race ethnic groups. And what we can see is that by 2042, the census predicts that America will be a majority-minority country. The increasing racial diversity is attributable to two factors in the U.S. First is the impact of immigration on the size and age structure of the U.S. I just kind of showed you those previous two slides. And within that factor, we know that immigrants tend to be younger than the average population because immigrants are more likely to take the risk of immigrating to another society than the elderly are. But we also know that our immigration policies favor the entry of the parents and other family members of these young immigrants. So a lot of immigrants are coming and they're bringing their families with them. The second factor is that major racial and ethnic groups are aging at different rates. And this all depends on fertility rates within groups, mortality rates within groups, and immigration rates within groups. So those two factors are primarily going to determine why we become a more diverse society in terms of race and ethnicity over time. So the percentage of whites is predicted to decline from about 63% of the population today to about 47% of the population in 2050. The percentage of Hispanics is predicted to increase from 17% to 29% of the population over that same time period. The percentage of Asians is predicted to increase from 5% to 9% of the population over that time. Those are the two largest groups of immigrants, people coming from Hispanic countries and Asian countries. Now, note there's a lot of diversity even within those groups as well, and they all bring different skills, levels of education, and resources with them to this country. The African American population isn't going to change a whole lot. It's only predicted to grow by about 1 percentage point. And it's been held pretty steady, about 11, 12% over the last 50 years in the US. Those are the traditional things that we think about in terms of diversity. But there are some emerging trends among those of us who are interested in diversity that need to be acknowledged as well. So for example, the LGBT movement has helped push sexual orientation and gender identity up the list of public issues. So now, as a result of more and more people from the LGBT community speaking out about their situation, we're becoming more aware that this population exists in our society and that they have some needs that are different from the kind of heteronorm in society. Now, while it is difficult to get accurate data on the percentage of the population that is LGBT, one of the more reliable studies, which I'm citing here from the Williams Institute Law School, puts them at about 3.5% of the population. And I've seen estimates that range from 1.5% all the way up to 9%. This one's kind of right in the middle there. Just over 8 million Americans identify as being lesbian, gay, or bisexual, and an additional 700,000 identify as transgender. These numbers are likely to change in the future because just like we know as we begin to understand that race is a social construct and that's influenced the way that we measure and think about race in society, well, gender, sexual orientation, gender identity, those are social constructs as well. And as the traditional male-female gender binary gives way to more inclusive gender classifications and measurement improves, these numbers are sure to change as a result. But this is a starting point. There's millions of people that we don't usually think about who are living their lives as part of the LGBT community, and they should be listened to. Disability status is also on the radar of people who are looking at trends in diversity. We know that disability is defined in terms of three different domains. There's a bunch of different ways to define diversity. I use the census definitions for the purposes of this presentation. There's three domains: communicative, mental, and physical disabilities. Communicative disabilities have to do with people who are experiencing blindness or have severely limited eyesight, who are deaf or have severely limited hearing, or people who have severe speech impediments. Okay, so it limits their ability to communicate in various ways. Mental disabilities are classified as learning disabilities, intellectual disabilities, developmental disabilities, Alzheimer's, senility, dementia, or other mental and emotional conditions that seriously interfere with everyday activities. Oops, I meant to turn the page, not. Physical disabilities are, for example, people who need to use wheelchairs or canes or crutches or walkers to get around. People who have difficulty walking, climbing, lifting objects over 10 pounds, or getting out of bed, and any other illnesses and diseases that limit physical activity. Nearly one out of every five Americans is classified as having one of these types of disabilities in the United States. That equates to about 57 million people in the US. And here I've got the breakdown by age and the severity of disability that you can look at there. Of those 57 million people, about 38 million of them, which is about 12% of our population, were severely disabled. And so, again, this is a significant percentage of the population who all bring considerable resources, skills, knowledge, and abilities to the table, but who need to be able to have, for example, the Disabilities Act, which made sure that people with wheelchairs can have access to buildings, that we can have access to technology for people who may have hearing or seeing disabilities so that they can still participate and contribute to the workforce and the labor market, right? So there's things that need to be taken into consideration as we acknowledge this as part of the changing nature of our society. So we can see that society is changing, our conception of what diversity means is changing, we're becoming more diverse, and we're expanding our idea of what diversity means. Well, the question that I was asked to answer in this presentation is, well, why does any of this matter? Well, it matters for a lot of reasons, most of which I won't be able to fit into the next 15, 20 minutes for this presentation, but I thought I would pull out some of the main policy issues that are going to need to be addressed now and in the future, as well as some of the economic and civic issues that we're going to be confronted with as we move into the future as well. So we know that the changing demographics of the United States will have an ever-increasing impact on a wide range of social, economic, and political issues in coming years. The nature of work in the labor market is changing. The demographics of the labor market are changing. The retirement population is growing. Therefore, people who need to have some kind of an income after they stop working is growing. Where is that money going to come from? Private sources, public sources? We need to deal with those issues. There's issues related to private wealth and income security. There are massive disparities in income, in the distribution of income and wealth in the United States along a number of dimensions, particularly along the dimensions of race and ethnicity and disability status. We know that, for example, the average net worth of the average white American is more than 7 times higher than the net worth of the average African American. We know that the average income for white Americans is significantly higher than the average income for African Americans and Hispanic Americans, right? This is important as we think about priorities for the federal budget and intergenerational equity. Income is important, but it turns out wealth may be even more important as we move ahead into the future, because wealth are those assets that we have in addition to our income, such as our financial investments, our real estate that we own, property that we own, other types of, all the things that if we cash them in, what's our total net worth, right? Well, the average white American has a net worth of over $600,000. I don't quite fit in that myself, but the average person does. The average African American person in the United States has an average net worth of about $100,000. As the older generations die and they leave some of their wealth to the next generation, that perpetuates inequality and social mobility as we move forward. We need to think about what does that mean for the future of our country as we become increasingly more diverse and as our wealth and income resources become concentrated into a smaller and smaller number of people's hands. The issue of inequality has been coming up a lot lately. I'm a sociologist and we think a lot about these things. Healthcare and health spending are issues as we move into the future with an aging population and with a population that is, with one out of every five Americans having some form of disability. We also know chronic illnesses are on the rise. How are we going to pay for this? How are we going to deal with these issues? And then, of course, there's immigration policy and how do we handle both legal and illegal forms of immigration into the United States. In terms of work, retirement, and pensions, the aging population and declining labor force participation are increasingly putting a strain on our public pension systems, Social Security, right? We always hear about the solvency of Social Security and what can we do to deal with that. Well, we also know that the labor force is projected to grow at a slower pace over the next 10 years than it has in recent decades, which means we're going to have less workers paying into Social Security at the same time that the baby boomers who are retiring at a rate of 10,000 people per day are going to be depending on Social Security as their primary form of income because the majority of Americans have $0 saved for retirement in the United States right now. So due to slower growth in the U.S. population and declining labor force participation, this is going to be an issue, and between 2000 and 2010, the labor force grew at an average annual rate of 1.1%. Between 2010 and 2020, it is projected to grow at an annual rate of just 0.7%. That's, demography is destiny, right? We're coming head on to some serious problems here as our workforce ages out of the workforce and begins to retire. In terms of private wealth and income security, the aging of the population presents two challenges. The first is we need to make sure that we're ensuring sufficient income security in the retirement years so that when people retire, they're not falling into poverty. Social Security has been the number one preventer of poverty for people of retirement age in the United States. For example, in 2010, the before transfer poverty rate, and I'm talking about government transfers in terms of Social Security and other benefits, the before transfer poverty rate for Americans over the age of 65 was 47% of the American population. The after transfer poverty rate for Americans over the age of 65 was 12%. Social Security matters for the people who are retiring. It's what keeps us out of poverty and gives us a steady income and a reliable income to make sure we can have the necessities we need for a good retirement. We also need to ensure that we're providing the retired population with protection against periods of poor health and or disability. Medicare, right? That's the big kind of elephant in the room that's blowing up our deficits right now in the United States. Healthcare costs are soaring. More and more that's contributing to the debt and deficits of our country, and we need to be able to shore that up in a responsible way where we're not leaving people behind so that they're suffering in the later years and they can enjoy those retirement years. It's also important to consider the fact that there are substantial differences in wealth and income between whites and non-whites and between women and men, which impacts resources available for current retirees and exacerbates these challenges for future retirees. Things that we'll be needing to keep on the radar as we talk about public policy as we move into the future. The federal budget and intergenerational equity is another issue. As the population has aged, conditions for children have deteriorated, but they've actually improved dramatically for older Americans. We might expect, as we have more people of retirement age and fewer kids in society, that would mean we have more resources for educating and providing our kids with opportunities. But it turns out that's not what's ended up happening. We've actually been disinvesting from public education and other public sources of support for our children, and we've been increasing the quality of life for our elderly population. And so we need to consider that as social programs have dramatically reduced poverty among the elderly over the past several generations, we have been substantially decreasing the amount of support that helps with poverty for younger Americans, particularly younger Americans from diverse non-white backgrounds, although a higher and higher percentage of white Americans are falling into poverty and falling into these issues as well. Lower investments in education and workforce development are going to mean a less skilled, lower income workforce who will rely on social safety net programs as they enter the workforce. Consider this. Last year, 58% of working Americans were on food stamps in the United States, were eligible for supplemental nutrition assistance in the United States. That's working Americans, people who have jobs but don't make enough money to be above the poverty line. These are working poor Americans. A growing number of workers, particularly those with young children, are not provided with health care through their employers and are therefore receiving health care through public programs such as Medicaid and CHIP, or the Children's Health Insurance Program. We need to pay for these. We need to make sure that these are solvent programs, because without healthy children, it'll be virtually impossible to have productive workers in the future. Many Americans have little to no personal savings for retirement, and this is especially true among non-whites in society. Savings rates have been going up since the recession, and before the recession, we were actually at negative savings as a society of individuals, but now they are starting to go up, particularly among the wealthier among us, but we're still having issues among the bottom half of people, who a substantial proportion of which are non-white or fall in some of those diverse backgrounds that I talked about. In terms of, just one more point on that, wealth and income disparities are significant issues for retiring minorities and for social mobility for a younger, more diverse society that we have, okay? And these disparities are getting bad. They're getting really bad. The average disparity in income, the disparity in income now between what the top 5% of Americans has relative to the bottom 95% is as high as it was the year before the Great Depression in the US. In terms of healthcare and health spending, over the projected period from 2010 to 2020, average annual health spending growth is anticipated to outpace average annual growth in the overall economy by about 1.1 percentage points. So healthcare spending is projected to grow at about 5.8% between 2010 and 2020, while annual growth in our GDP is only projected to grow by about 4.7%. Changes in population size, racial and ethnic composition, and age structure affect the healthcare resources that are needed, the spending levels for those resources, and the health conditions that we're observing. By 2020, national health care spending is expected to reach $4.6 trillion and comprise 19.8% of GDP. So one out of every $5 of our productivity will be going towards health care costs in the United States. By comparison, most other industrialized countries in the world spend about 8 to 10% of their GDP on healthcare expenses. We're spending twice the amount of our money on healthcare on average, and our returns are about in the middle of the pack. I think we were ranked 37th or something like that the last time I looked among comparable nations. We're spending more and we're getting worse results as a result. According to a recent report by the American Medical Association, without Medicare reform and an adequate safety net for the younger population, the health status of the U.S. population is likely to decline. This is going to exacerbate these issues. Local and national government programs to provide age-appropriate and culturally proficient health care will likely alter patterns of health care to meet the needs of diverse populations. We're dealing with this here in our community. They're dealing with this in communities across the country. Providing increased support for public health programs that are designed to address healthcare knowledge, prevention, treatment adherence, and barriers related to culture, language, and health literacy will likely contribute to improving the health status of the U.S. population if we make that a priority. Improving access to medical care and addressing the underlying determinants are necessary to aid the growing number of people with chronic diseases in making appropriate health decisions and adhere to physician treatment plans. So these are things that we need to take into account. Failure to strengthen the U.S. education system and labor market will have major implications for the nation's economy, as well as negative consequences for the health status of our nation. As we know, people living in poverty, people with a high school degree or less, are more likely to have significant health conditions than people who are wealthier and who have higher levels of education. So increasing support for the public health infrastructure and promoting collaboration between physician practices and community health resources may improve health outcomes as well as reduce healthcare spending relatable to preventable illnesses. We focus too little on prevention in our society, not just in healthcare, but among a lot of dimensions when we look at the sources of the problems that we've got. Exactly. So those are some of the main issues that you hear talked about a lot among politicians, among community leaders, and among others. And I want to talk a little bit about, as sociologists, what are some of the things that we think about. There are additional political benefits and challenges that diversity brings, other economic challenges and benefits, and other civic challenges and benefits. Politically, we need to be thinking about policies that are oriented towards cultural integration and public support for programs that provide opportunities for mobility. We saw in the last two presidential elections a new coalition emerge among the Democratic Party, a coalition among the young, among the less affluent, among the more diverse, read non-white, and among people from the LGBT community tending to form a political coalition that is upsetting the traditional political lines based on race and class in the United States that has been the focus of our politics for too long in this country. If our political parties do not adapt to this new reality, they're going to become irrelevant. And this is a political problem going into the future. If we do not acknowledge the growing diversity of our nation and the needs of that increasingly diverse population, we're going to be stuck with a situation like we've been experiencing for the last several years that's characterized by gridlock, a lack of consensus on issues, and a lack of understanding about what the causes and solutions to the pressing political problems of our day are. Thank you. I'm just reporting it, I didn't come up with this stuff. Economically, it's very important for us to consider that the demographic characteristics of a more diverse nation are not encouraging at this point. We know that people from non-white backgrounds are segregated into worse schools than whites are on average. They have lower investment in public education, in workforce development. They're going on to have lower college acceptance and completion rates. They're going on to have jobs that are most likely going to be in the service sector, which are low-wage jobs, don't provide benefits, health care, and those other things. We need to make it a focus of our economic policies to make sure that we are providing access to quality jobs and training to improve incomes and to promote equity and wealth attainment across differences in our society. And I want to spend some time talking about how this affects our communities. The United States, Springfield is actually one of the least diverse cities of its size in the entire country. After the 2000 census, we were actually the second least diverse city next to Portland, Maine. I think we've done a little bit better since the 2010 census, but I'm still pretty sure we're in the top five least diverse areas. But we are becoming more diverse. And organizations, our workforce is becoming more diverse, our education institutions are becoming more diverse. And so these are issues that, while the Midwest has largely been insulated from these issues historically, it's starting to happen. This is starting to become a priority in communities, and I showed you some of those examples. As a result of the increasing diversity of our communities, managing the social relations that come along with the differences that people are bringing along with them becomes increasingly difficult and is increasingly becoming more of a priority. How do we deal with these differences in a way that makes our community stronger rather than in a way that makes us divided? We know that there are benefits to diversity. Research has shown that diversity spawns creativity. Many studies of collective creativity in work groups, in business settings, education settings, etc., other settings, find that diversity fosters creativity and that it produces much better, faster problem solving, and it limits groupthink. When you have people with different experiences and different perspectives all sitting around trying to solve issues, you can come up with better solutions more efficiently and more quickly than you can if you have a group of people who all bring the same ideas, knowledge, and information to the table. We know that immigration is generally associated with more rapid economic growth. That's been one of the defining characteristics of the U.S. economy since, who knows when, over the last couple hundred years. The net effect of immigration is to increase national income. So when we have an immigration policy that works, it benefits all of us as a community. Native-born Americans' incomes increase more rapidly, all things equal, if they live in places with more immigrants than if they live in places with fewer immigrants. That may be a counterintuitive thing, but research bears this out. In countries with aging populations, immigration is important to offset the impending fiscal effects of the retirement of the baby boom generation. So as our workforce is comprised more and more of younger immigrants, we're going to depend on them to support us as we retire. So it makes sense to want them to have good paying jobs, because that means they can pay more into the Social Security program that we all depend on to make sure we're not retiring into poverty when we get older. Now, there are also significant challenges associated with diversity. For example, research has shown that there's a negative correlation between ethnic diversity and social solidarity. Across work groups in the United States as well as in Europe, internal heterogeneity in terms of age, professional background, ethnicity, and other factors is generally associated with lower group cohesion, lower satisfaction, and higher turnover. Across countries, greater ethnic heterogeneity seems to be associated with lower social trust, a key indicator of social capital. In American census tracts, often used as a proxy for neighborhoods, greater ethnic heterogeneity is associated with lower rates of carpooling, which is a social practice that embodies trust and reciprocity. Again, another key aspect of social capital. Within experimental game settings, such as Prisoner Dilemma or Ultimatum games, players who are more different from one another, regardless of whether or not they actually know each other, are more likely to defect or cheat. Such results have been reported in many countries from Uganda to the United States. So with increasing diversity and heterogeneity comes a sense, if you think about a turtle withdrawing into its shell, right? We have a tendency to want to hunker down when people that we don't know or that we don't feel like we can understand or we don't feel like we relate to are moving into our communities. And the net impact of that is an erosion in our civic infrastructure, an erosion in our ability to collaborate across differences to collectively solve the problems that we face as a community, an erosion in the trust that we need in order to be able to make our economy work better, an erosion in that quality of life that we come to appreciate and respect about the opportunities that we want for our families and for our children. These are all things that a focus, an intentional focus on building what sociologists refer to as social capital can help to address. Social capital is referred to as the social networks and the associated norms of trustworthy and reciprocity that come with that. Social networks are resources that have value for both individuals and communities. Areas that have high levels of social capital have better health outcomes, increased levels of public safety, higher levels of education, higher levels of happiness, more responsive government, and more economic resilience during economic downturns. Places where people are more integrated, where people interact with each other, and where people cooperate and work together function better than places where people just hunker down and settle into networks of people that look like themselves. We need to focus on building both bonding and bridging social capital. Bonding social capital are the ties to people who are like you in some important way, whether it's your race or your education level or your religious beliefs. Bridging social capital are ties to people who are unlike you in important ways. And research suggests that increasing racial ethnic diversity erodes both types of social capital, and we withdraw into our shells and we don't leave our house as much. We watch more TV. We're not out getting involved in our community and doing these things. So, again, we know that there's a bunch of indicators of civic participation in social capital that pose challenges as diversity increases in these communities. Diversity seems to trigger what sociology is referred to as anomie or social isolation. Robert Putnam, a prominent political scientist, labels this constrict theory. We constrict the extent to which we connect and are working with others. Well, what do we do about this? Well, we need to have intentional policies that provide new members of our communities with opportunities to get connected, to interact, to engage with each other, and to try to come together to solve those collective problems that we all face as a community in a productive way, so that we can go from an us versus them mentality to a we mentality. We're all in this. And social psychologists and sociologists have found that people find it easier to trust one another, to cooperate, when the social distance between them is less. We can intentionally create opportunities through programs and organizations that create those, that reduce that distance between people by working in neighborhoods that are diverse, by working in communities that have this diversity. If we think about diversity itself, it can only be conceived in terms of socially constructed identities, going back to that beginning part of the talk that I was saying, and how our different identities intersect to lead to who we are, right? Thus, adapting over time dynamically to immigration and overall increases in diversity requires the restructuring or reconstruction of our social identities. Not just saying that the immigrants need to assimilate to our culture, but also to think of our new diverse society as a whole, including those of us who have been here for a long time. Great quote by Trevor Phillips, the chair of the British Commission on Human Rights, and I'll leave you with this. We need to respect people's ethnicity, but also give them, at some point in the week, an opportunity to meet and want to be with people with whom they have something in common that is not defined by their ethnicity. And I would expand that beyond ethnicity to talk about other types of differences that we talk about, whether it's sexual orientation, gender, disability, age, or those types of things. If we can do that, we can solve problems more efficiently, more effectively, and create the society that harnesses the benefits of diversity and limits the challenges that are associated with it. Thank you.